ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ अज्ञानतिमिरान्धस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरुवे नमः। श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपः कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकं। वन्देऽहं श्रीगुरोः श्रीयुतापदकमलं श्रीगुरून् वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं साग्रजातं सहगण रघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनसहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधाकृष्णपादान् सहगणललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितांश्च। नमः ॐ विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिनिति नामिने। नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषशून्यवादी पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे। नमो महावदन्याय कृष्णप्रेम प्रदायते कृष्णाय कृष्णचैतन्या नामिने गौरतुसे नमः। हे कृष्णकरुणासिन्धु दीनबन्धु जगत्पते गोपेश गोपिकाकान्त राधाकान्त नमोस्तुते। तप्त काञ्चन गौराङ्गी राधे वृन्दावनेश्वरी वृषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरिप्रिये। मूकं करोति वाचालं पङ्गुं लङ्घायते गिरिं यत्कृपातमहं वन्दे श्रीगुरून् दीनतारिणं परमानन्दमाधवं श्रीचैतन्यमीश्वरं। वाञ्छाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्रीकृष्णचैतन्या प्रभुनित्यानन्द श्री अद्वैतगदाधर श्रीवासादिगौरभक्तवृन्द। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। हरे कृष्णा। Thank you very much for coming, and thank you very much for encouraging me and giving me this chance to speak. So I don't get much opportunity to speak here, but it's said that when Lord gives in plenty. In Hindi they say, jab Bhagwan deta hai, to chappad phaad ke deta hai. Chappad means, you have seen the hut of a poor beggar. The hut, the ceiling of the hut is called chappad. So when Lord gives, He tears open the chappar, the ceiling of the hut, and gives. So I have got 4 shlokas today. Of course, 1 shloka has purport. So with that humor, a little piece of humor, I would like to seriously meditate on the dust of the lotus feet of all my senior devotees and all my so-called junior and so-called equal devotees, and try to speak something on Prabhupada's purport. It's a very interesting section going on. I'll just give the summary of the section. Okay, first I'll give the name. The title which I would be discussing on, the title would be Process of Becoming Fearless. How to become Abhayam or fearless. Because Prabhupada speaks about that in the purport to the 64th shloka, which is on the board. So the section which is going on is Narad is telling Yudhishthira Maharaj about the greatness of Lord Krishna as compared to all other demigods, and especially as compared to the Mahadev, who is Lord Shiva, who is the devas of all the devas. So if Lord Shiva doesn't come anywhere close to Lord Krishna, then what to talk about any other 33 crore minus 1 demigods? Minus 1 is Lord Shiva is 1. So this is the section going on, and Yudhishthira Maharaj, before Narad Muni started this, Yudhishthira Maharaj asked the question. Narad Muni was glorifying Yudhishthira Maharaj and all the Pandavas. And after glorifying, he said, and Lord Shiva, Lord Krishna is one who was serving you Pandavas, and that Lord Krishna is the person who one time saved Lord Shiva from being embraced at the hands of Maidana. And with that, the inquisitiveness of Yudhishthira Maharaj came out, and he said immediately, stop. What was that? He said to Narada Muni, what was that leela or that that incident, historical incident, where Lord Krishna saved Lord Shiva? And why Maidana, what Maidana had against Lord Shiva that Maidana wanted to defeat him or embarrass him? With that, the section starts, and here we are where, of course, it started 3-4 shlokas before, and Lord, the story goes as follows. It's not story, I would say it's incident, a historical event. It goes as follows, that Lord Shiva, as usual, demigods and asuras, demigods and demons, they had a fight, and demigods got defeated at the hands of demons, and they took shelter of Maidana. And Maidana saved them. Maidana made 3 celestial places. They were invisible to the demigods. And when he made, the demigods could defeat them, the demons could defeat all the demigods. And when the demigods got defeated, demigods approached Lord Shiva for help. And Lord Shiva came. Lord Shiva immediately destroyed them, could not destroy those invisible places, their residential places, but he destroyed the demons, and the demons fell down. When they were falling down, Maidana caught hold of them, and he made them dip into a pond of nectar, or a well of nectar. And then this starts, where what happened after that here. So I'll read 60, 61, 62, and 63, and then 64th we'll recite, and then we'll read the purport. So 60th, 7th canto, 10th chapter, 60th shloka. When the dead bodies of the demons came in touch with the nectar, their bodies became invincible to thunderbolts. Endowed with great strength, they got up like lightning penetrating clouds. 61. Seeing Lord Shiva very much aggrieved and disappointed, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Vishnu, considered how to stop this nuisance created by Maidana. 62. Then Lord Brahma became a calf and Lord Vishnu a cow. And at noon, they entered the residences and drank all the nectar in the well. 63. The demons could see the calf and cow, but because of the illusion created by the energy of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the demons could not forbid them. The great mystic Maidana became aware that the calf and cow were drinking the nectar, and he could understand this to be the unseen power of providence. Thus, he spoke to the demons, who were grievously lamenting. And 64th, we'll recite the 64th shloka. Devo suro naro neova Neshwaro stiha kashchana Atmano nyasya vadishtam Daive napohitum dvayoho Devo suro naro nyova Neshwaro stiha kashchana Atmano nyasya vadishtam Daive napohitum dvayoho. Word for meaning, word for word meaning, translation and purport by His Divine Grace, Abhay Charanarvind Bhakti Vedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. Word for word, Devaha, the demigods. Asuraha, the demons. Naraha, humans. Anyaha, or anyone else. Va, either. Na, not. Ishwaraha, the Supreme Controller. Asti is. Iha, in this world. Kashchana, anyone. Atmanaha, one's own. Anyasya, another's. Va, either. Dishtam, destiny. Daivena, which is given by the Supreme Lord. Apohitum, to undo. Dvayoho, of both of them. Now note, this is spoken by Maidana, what he is speaking. even a dano. Today we call atheist people or outside scorn people as materialists or as demons sometimes. But they don't have any understanding about this. Okay, they don't talk like this. This is so sensible. This is really, what he is speaking is really from the Vedas. So Maidana said, what has been destined by the Supreme Lord for oneself, for others, or for both oneself and others, cannot be undone anywhere or by anyone, whether one be a demigod, a demon, a human being, or anyone else. So just to bring you back to what is going on, Maidana is speaking to the Asuras, because the Asuras Asuras fell into the nectar well, but then Lord Vishnu is coming and Lord Brahma is coming as cow and calf, and they have drunk the nectar. Now next time when Lord Shiva kills them, then nobody is going to save them. So now Maidana, after getting defeated completely, a person gets defeated these days in the world. When a person gets defeated, he gets completely broken down in life, his property collapses, his business collapses, everything collapses, then the only resort what he takes to is suicide. He doesn't go to the Supreme Lord. He doesn't speak like this. But Maidana is so cool-headed. And this is first thing, to become Abhayam. Abhayam means to take shelter. Of course, how to become fearless is very simple. To take shelter, for us ISKCON devotees, is to take shelter of one who is Abhay. Abhay Charanarvind Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. And how to access him? Through his teachings, very simple teachings. And his teachings are really simple. They are for those who are scholarly, very scholarly people. They also appreciate. Those who are Sanskrit scholars, Vedic scholars, they also appreciate. Those who are scholars in English, they also appreciate. And those who are mediocre in both the things, English as well as Sanskrit, they also appreciate. And those who are completely laymen, they also appreciate. So his teachings are there, but he directs us to take shelter of the Supreme Lord. And here Maidana said, what has been destined by the Supreme Lord for oneself, for others, or for both oneself and others, cannot be undone anywhere or by anyone, whether one be a demigod, a demon, a human being, or anyone else. Now purport, the Supreme Lord is one, Krishna, the Vishnu Tattva. Krishna expands himself into Vishnu Tattva, personal expansions, which are called Swamsha, who control everything. Maidana said, however I plan, you plan, or both of us plan, the Lord has planned what is to happen. No one's plan. Now this we should relate with ourselves. He is speaking to us. We plan so many things. I'll be this, I'll be that, I'll be a sannyasi, and I'll be a GBC, and president in his terms, and outside also we plan, I'll be next parliament minister and all those things, but nothing happens. However I plan, you plan, or both of us plan, the Lord has planned what is to happen. No one's plan will be successful without his sanction. He has already planned what is going to happen. We may make our own various plans, but unless they are sanctioned by the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Vishnu, they will never be successful. Hundreds and millions of plans are made by all kinds of living entities, but without the sanction of the Supreme Lord, they are completely, I'm adding this word, completely futile. And this is very instructive. Prabhupada, in so less words, this is called expertise, eloquent speech in Chaitanya Charitamrita is described. In few words, you can really touch the heart. You can speak so many things. And Prabhupada has spoken so many things, and we can keep on elaborating for millions of years. Still we won't come to the conclusion of what Prabhupada has spoken. So here, it said, Prabhupada is writing, that whatever, this is from Bhagavad Gita only, Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, I am three things. I am Upadrashta, Anumanta. Two things. Upadrashta and Anumanta. He is the witness and he is the sanctioner. And Prabhupada, in the introduction to Bhagavad Gita, he explains, the jiva can only desire to do something. He cannot actually do. He can desire, I'll do this. I'll pick up a glass of water and drink. He can only desire. Actually, he has nothing in control. The jiva is captured in this body, which is made of three gunas. And these three gunas are under the control of Lord Krishna. If I am supposed to, according to my previous karma, if I have given a glass of water to people, if I haven't made them hungry or thirsty, I'll get to drink this water. Otherwise, I won't get this water to drink. It may be in front of me. I won't be able to drink. And there are so many examples of this in the world. There are rich people, aristocratic people, stinking rich. They have money and everything. But doctor has said, you cannot eat these things. They have so many tables to eat. They can go to the restaurant. They can cook in their house. But they cannot eat because their quota is complete. One devotee was saying, diabetes. Yeah, Madhavendu Prabhu is sitting. I remembered by seeing at him. He was saying one time, I was eating sweets. And he said, okay, you can eat sweets. Whatever is your quota, now after the quota, you won't be able to eat. That means you will be afflicted by diabetes. Now, diabetes is only nimitta matram bhav savya sachin. It's only nimitta. Diabetes is superficial cause. The real cause is Krishna is not allowing me to eat sweets after a limit. That's it. And all limits, once we go to Vaikuntha, to the spiritual world, all limits are taken out. Madhumangal eats 1 crore laddus and then he criticizes the gopis. What are these laddus? Useless laddus. And you are feeding the Brahman only 1 lakh laddus. And he doesn't get affected by diabetes. So here we are restricted in this body, in this material world, when we get these bodies, we are restricted by Krishna. And karma comes with us. With us in this world. But in the spiritual world, we don't have to do any karma. So there are no reactions. So this is the first very important point. And now I'll shift a little bit to what is spoken in this. In the second part, I'll again come to the purport. But first, I'll focus on the section. The section emphasizes, in the purport, Prabhupada doesn't emphasize on Lord Shiva and Lord Krishna's position. But in the section, the Shiva's and Krishna's position are analyzed. So I'll go into that. There is a shloka in, before that, when we preach in India, especially in Indian public when we preach, or when Prabhupada was preaching, we face a very difficult task of saying, whenever we say that we have to, that Krishna is supreme, people become very disturbed. Because all over India, Shiva is supreme. Everyone is worshipping Shiva because all Indians are right. Currently, all Indians are looking toward opulence. They want opulence. And that's what in Leelamrita you'll find. Prabhupada, when he was preaching in India, Prabhupada was going from door to door with that small back to God at one paper he was printing. Small, one or two leaflets were there. And Prabhupada was going, and in one home, Prabhupada is saying in there, in one home, Prabhupada knocked and a woman came out. She had two doors. One door was with that net where she could see, but it was closed. And the other door she opened, she had a small kid. As soon as she saw, oh, some Swamiji has come, she covered the face with her veil of the sari. She covered the face of the little kid. And she said, oh, Swamiji, don't come here. Go, go, go. We don't want to follow all this Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavatam. Go away from here. Right now, I want my child to go to US. He should become a big man. And even Prabhupada's own mother, she desired Prabhupada to become a big magistrate, big advocate. And she wanted him to go and study in England. So all are going toward opulence. And who is giving opulence? Lord Shiva gives opulence. Krishna doesn't give any opulence. Krishna's devotees are always bigger. And they are always in difficulty. And that's why very few people want to take to Krishna's shelter. Because people want to be happy in this world. They want to do something where they want to be happy in this world. They don't believe in the next world actually. Nobody believes that there is some Vaikuntha, there's anything like that. Prabhupada says in one of the conversations that when Prabhupada's Guru Maharaj, Bhaktivedanta Saraswati, disappeared, after many years, some of the most senior disciples of Bhaktivedanta Saraswati, sannyasi disciples, came to Prabhupada and confided in Prabhupada. They asked Prabhupada, Abhay Babu, do you really believe? Now this is really eye-opening. The most senior disciples of Bhaktivedanta Saraswati, Prabhupada doesn't name them there, they said, Abhay Babu, do you really believe that what our Guru Maharaj was saying, Vaikuntha planets and spiritual world, do they really exist? And Prabhupada was really shocked, and in that conversation Prabhupada says, see, this is the position. If you read so many scriptures, Prabhupada says, my godbrothers were so scholarly that when they were giving class, I was only playing mridanga. I used to only sing for them. I never dared to give class in front of them. They were so scholarly. And when Bhakti Sanatana Saraswati used to speak, Bhakti Sanatana Saraswati used to just quote shlokas, never explain meaning. Because all the audience there at those in those times, they knew shlokas. They knew their meaning, but no realization. And this is the difference between these people. Maitano is speaking so many things, but he has no realization, no faith. And Prabhupada one place explains, Jai Shri Gaur Nitai Bhagwan Ki Jai Shri Krishna Balaram Bhagwan Ki Jai Shri Radha Shyam Sundar Lalita Vishakha Bhagwan Ki Jai. Prabhupada explains that what is the difference between a pure devotee and a new neophyte devotee. A neophyte devotee starts with Adav Shraddha. You know that nine steps, Adav Shraddha Tata Sadhu Sang Tata Bhajan Kriya Anartha Nipisi. So Adav Shraddha, and each step increases his Shraddha, his faith. And when that faith becomes very strong, that becomes bhav. Only the faith increases. And how to increase that faith is the process of becoming fearless. And this is the analytical study. We have to really analyze what is the position of Lord Shiva, what is the position of demigods, and what is the position of Lord Krishna. And here in Chaitanya Charitamrita, there is a very nice shloka which says, Vyamohaya characharasya jagatam te te puranagamas tam tam evahi devatam paramikam jalpantu kalpavidhi siddhante punar ek eva bhagavan vishnur samastagama vyapareshu vivechana vyatikaram. He says there, Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami, that all the scriptures, if you go through all the Vedic scriptures except Srimad Bhagavatam, Vyamohaya, what you will get is bewilderment only. Vyamohaya characharasya jagatam. And it bewilders whom? All, char as well as achar. The moving as well as non-moving living entities. Characharasya jagatam tete purana gamas. And all these scriptures, if you go through to Shiva Bhagavat, then Shiva Puran says, or not Shiva Bhagavat, Shiva Puran says that Shiva is the best. Go to Devi Puran, says Devi is the best. And people get confused. And Bhagavat Puran, Krishna is the best. Then who is the best? Whom to go to? And that confusion was even in the case of Atri Muni. You remember Atri Muni, when he was meditating, he was confused whom he is calling. He was calling the Supreme. And all three Supreme came. Mahesh, Vishnu, and Brahma. All three came. And they said, whom are you calling? He said, I don't know. whoever is great amongst you. They said, each one of us is great in something in this material world. And he did not know anything about the spiritual world. Prabhupada writes there. So they said, okay, we'll become Dattatreya, we'll combine. All three are great for you. So this should not be there. For a devotee to go back home, back to Godhead, just chanting Hare Krishna is not actually sufficient. Chanting Hare Krishna will purify the heart, and by purification of the heart, we'll be able to understand the Shastras more clearly, and thereby we'll be able to, and our conceptualization of the demigods and Lord Krishna will be very clear. We'll be very clear whom to take shelter of and whom to give respect. Now, this is very important. Some neophyte devotees, when they come to ISKCON, they become very, 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 very offending or disrespectful toward demigods sometimes. At other times, they say, Prabhu, tell me one thing. Respectful means what? Bowing down to somebody means I'm taking shelter of him. But the question is, we bow down to all Vaishnavas, and all demigods are Vaishnavas. They are the devotees of the Lord and much better than us. Bowing down to them is no problem, but bowing down with proper conception is the thing. If we have the conception that they are the appointed authorities of the Supreme Lord, so I am bowing down to them, respecting the authority of the Supreme Lord, that he has appointed them, so I bow down. Like Sanatan Goswami, he went to the Nawab and he said, oh Nawab, you are Nardev. Now, Nawab, he was a Yavan, he was a Muslim, he was a cow eater.
But right now, he has been positioned by the Supreme Lord. So I bow down. But not that he is the Supreme Lord. This is a very important thing. And this people don't have proper conception. So when we go to all the Vedas, we read all the Vedas without the guidance of the great acharyas, the great devotees of the Lord, then we get Vyamohaya. We become bewildered, who is the Supreme? But Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami says there, this is a quotation from Padma Puran. So Padma Puran says there that, but if you siddhante, if you go with siddhant, with proper understanding of tattva and scientific understanding, and you go through all the shlokas, not take out this shloka and neglect that shloka, then you will come to the understanding that Vishnur Bhagavan Eka Eva, that Vishnu is one Bhagavan. And that we should understand with all the stories or all the leelas of Lord Shiva and Lord Krishna. And you will find there is not even one, I may be wrong, I'm not Paramatma to say this, but I haven't come across one leela where Shiva protects Lord Vishnu. Is there some leela where Shiva has protected Lord Vishnu? There are leelas where Lord Krishna or Lord Ramchandra goes and worship Lord Shiva. Like Lord Ramchandra, before crossing the ocean to go to Lanka, he worshiped Lord Shiva. Lord Krishna worships Sudama Brahman also. That doesn't make Sudama Brahman better than Lord Shiva, Lord Krishna. So Lord Krishna is such a humble Lord, that's why he is God. He is so humble that he worships his devotees. And as the greatest devotee, Lord Shiva, Lord Krishna, of course, Lord Ramchandra, of course, worships him. But there is no one instance where Lord Krishna or Lord Vishnu has been saved by Lord Shiva. And there are so many instances where Lord Vishnu saves Lord Shiva. And there is one, this instance, and there is another instance. Yesterday, when I was preparing, I went through Banasura's story. And I got inspired. I was thinking, I'll make it brief, but I'll make it a little elaborate. Now, after knowing the Shruti fall of that story, the Shruti fall, Shukdev Goswami says, whoever hears this narration, especially in the morning time, whoever hears this narration of Lord Shiva and Lord Krishna's fight to save Banasura, what happens to him, especially in the morning if he hears, then what happens to him is, he doesn't have to face defeat anywhere or anytime in his struggle for life. So with that, I would narrate this little story, very nice story, 64th chapter of 10th canto, where Banasura was Lord Shiva's devotee, very, very ardent devotee. And he was such a nice devotee that when Lord Shiva was dancing, he was doing his tandav nritya with his 1,000 arms, which were gifted by Lord Shiva himself. With his 1,000 arms, he was playing drums. And Lord Shiva became very joyful to dance in that. And he benedicted him that whatever is your desire will be fulfilled. And you can ask me whatever is your desire. So so Banasura said, oh Lord Shiva, I don't want anything. I want only one thing. You be the gatekeeper of my palace, of my kingdom. And if you are there, I am protected from all enemies. So Lord Shiva said, okay, so be it. After that, Banasura became very, very powerful. A 1,000 arms, and always it was itching. He went out, he wanted to fight with so many people, but he could not meet anybody who was his real opponent. As soon as people saw him, they ran away. So he said, he came to Lord Shiva, and Lord Shiva, you have given me 1,000 arms, and you have given me so much power, but there is nobody who is my equal. I cannot fight with anybody. Lord Shiva became very angry because he said, I don't see anybody except you. Lord Shiva became very angry. He wants to fight with me only. One who made him powerful, he wants to fight with me. Lord Shiva chastised him. He said, you'll meet, you rascal, you fool, you are so proud of your power. You'll meet a person soon who will defeat, who will vanquish your pride. And then Leela goes on, his daughter falls in love with Lord Krishna's grandson Aniruddha, and then she falls in love, and then he captures them. Then Lord Krishna comes, and Lord Krishna fights with him, And when Lord Krishna was fighting, Lord Shiva came to his defense with all his hobgoblins, Kartikeya, Ganpati, everyone. And there was a very fierce fight going on, very fierce fight. Lord Krishna was fighting with Lord Shiva, and Lord Shiva was using so many weapons, Lord Krishna was defeating him right and left. Finally, Lord Shiva used his Shivjwar. Before that, he used his Pashupatastra, but afterwards, he used his Shivjwar. And Shivjwar was contracted by Narayanjwar. Shivjwar is very heavy heat, and Narayanjwar is very cold. And Prabhupada writes, when very heavy heat is there, if cold is there, gradually heat subsides. So Narayanjwar became victorious, and Shivjwar saw that Lord Shiva could not give him shelter. So Shivjwar went to Lord Krishna. He said, he glorified Lord Krishna that you are the supreme power. I was just in confusion and I was in illusion that Lord Shiva could protect me, but Lord Shiva is unable to protect me. Please protect me. And then Lord Krishna blesses him that no, from now on you will have no fear from Narayanjwar and you will have no fear from any of your enemies. Then Lord Krishna went to Banasur. And Lord Krishna saw Banasur is fighting so fiercely, Lord Krishna broke his horses and his chariot. Then Lord Krishna went away from there. Then Banasur came behind him. Of course, in between something else happened. Then Banasur came behind him and Banasur started again fighting with the support of Lord Shiva. But this time, Lord Krishna used his Sudarshan Chakra. He cut all his arms, except four arms were remaining. All the arms were cut. And then Banasura became very, very much depressed. He went to Lord Shiva, do something. Then Lord Shiva became enraged. Lord Shiva said, come on, Lord Krishna, you have to fight with me. And Lord Shiva started fighting with such valor, but nothing happened in front of Lord Krishna. Finally, Lord Krishna defeats Lord Shiva. Lord Shiva surrenders to him, but Lord Shiva says, oh Lord Krishna, you are the Supreme Soul. You are the three deities. Actually, we are just for the namesake, we are not able to maintain. We are creating that also by your power, and I am annihilating that is also by your power. So, Lord, but one thing is there. He begs Lord Krishna. He says, oh Lord Krishna, one thing is there. This Banasura is my dear devotee, and I have promised him that I'll always protect him. And you remember, you promised Prahlad Maharaj that you will never kill any of his descendants. Lord Krishna said, yes, yes, I remember that. I will not kill him. That's why I haven't killed him. I could have killed him. I remember that promise. That's why I have saved his four hands. From now on, he'll be invincible. He will be amar, immortal. He will never be killed by anyone. And he'll be a very good devotee of yours and will always be faithful to you. And that Shukdeva Goswami says this Falshruti, that whoever hears this narration in the morning, meditates on this fight between Lord Krishna and Lord Shiva, will never face any defeat in his struggle for life. Now, this is very, very important thing. To become Abhaya, we have to take shelter of Lord Krishna. And to take shelter of Lord Krishna, the most important thing is our conception has to be right. Our conception, if the conception is wrong, then everything will be spoiled. Our chanting of the holy names, Prabhupada writes in the Nectar of Instruction, in the introduction, the advancement of a devotee, the advancement of the chanter depends on his manovritti or on his attitude. What is his attitude? If the attitude is very clear, then we'll get to the goal. If the attitude is not clear, then we'll become like Atri Muni. And for making our attitude clear, there is very nice series of shlokas in the 11th canto. And the shloka says why a person is in fear in this material world. The first shloka, the famous shloka which Prabhupada used to quote, you must all be knowing, Bhayam dutiyah abhinivesh syad ishad apetasya viparyayo asmritihi. Says that bhayam dutiyah, as soon as a person sees duality in this material world, Krishna is said advaya jnan. Krishna is called advaya jnan. Advaya jnan means he is non-different. He is not two, he is one. And God is one. Okay. And that as soon as we forget Krishna, asmritihi viparyayo, we look away from Krishna, we come into this material world. And this, in this material world, we see two differences. Always, pain and pleasure, good and bad, light and heat, light and darkness. These things are not present in the spiritual world, because the spiritual world is like Krishna, Advaita Jnana. There is existence of pleasure there without the existence of sadness or misery. In this material world, Prabhupada used to say, in this material world, what is pleasure? Prabhupada used to give the example, very funny example. In this material world, people strike their head with the wall and starts bleeding. And then they come out, oh, they do like this, and that is called pleasure. Freedom from misery is called pleasure. First you take misery and then you take pleasure. And that's what Prabhupada said to the hippies. His disciples were hippies. And he said, you people were stinking rich and you had no misery in this world. So you were not experiencing any pleasure. There was blankness. What is there apart from this? They were born with silver spoon. Very rich. America is very rich. So they became hippies, they became beggar to understand what is the pleasure of having money. But in the spiritual world, people are stinking rich, but they are happy. And that is Advaita Jnana. And here it says, Bhayam Dutiyah Abhineveshatah Syat. Why a person becomes fearful in this material world? Because he forgets Krishna. Asmritihi, and he comes in this material world and he tries to become lord of all he surveys. That is the difficulty. As soon as a person takes shelter of Krishna, he becomes fearless, like Prahlad Maharaj. Prahlad Maharaj was standing in front of Hiranyakashipu. Hiranyakashipu asked, who is making you fearless? What is your strength? And what Prahlad Maharaj said? Prahlad said, Na kevalam me bhavatascha rajan savai balam balinam aparesham. He said, oh my father, of course he never called him father, he said, oh best of the demons, listen to me. Na kevalam me bhavatascha rajan. What, you are asking for my strength? The source of my strength is the source of your strength. Now just think. Hiranyakashipu had the power, had the military of all the universe. Now here Prabhupada writes in this purport, the purport which we are discussing on, Prabhupada says, I'm using another terminology, another phrase of Prabhupada. Prabhupada says, not even a blade of grass moves without the sanction of Lord Krishna. Now, what does this mean? This means that if the full military force, air force and navy force of all the world, hypothetical case, all the forces of the world, all human beings, all animals come against me, Prana Govindas, sitting here, they come against me with all their military power and they want to kill me here. They won't be able to kill me if Krishna doesn't want. Now, this faith is very difficult to have. This faith, we become fearful. As soon as somebody says, oh, I'll do this with you, we become fearful. One person can kill us. We feel that he can harm us. But Prahlad Maharaj was standing in front of a person who had the power of the whole universe. And he says, oh, Asur Varya, don't worry. The source of power, the source of your power is the source of my power. And he is the source of the all-powerful people in this world. And then he says, don't think just that much. He is actually all the controllers of this world, of this, all the three planetary systems, all demigods, and even Brahma and Lord Shiva are under the control of Lord Krishna. And he has given me that power. That's why I'm telling you these things. Now, this is how this came to Prahlad Maharaj, a very important thing. Why Prahlad Maharaj had so much intelligence and so much guts or so much faith. From where that faith comes? Faith comes with jnanam. That's why Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, my best devotee or the devotee who is very dear to me is a devotee who is jnani. What happens with jnana? There are two types of jnana. Sometimes devotees, those who take to Brahma Madhav Gaudiya Sampradaya, they become very neglectful of jnana. They say, don't become a jnani bhakta. Do you want to become jnani? You know, jnani, Vishwamitra and all, they fell down to maya. Don't become jnani. But there are two types of gyan. There is one gyan which is gyan to show off, and another gyan which is to take shelter of Lord Krishna. One gyan where the conception is, oh, because the acharyas have written so many books, they want us to read, and that will open our eyes, jnana chakshu or shastra chakshu. Without reading shastras, we want to have that chakshu to see Lord Krishna's hand in protecting us. Why? Right now we also don't see Krishna everywhere, and Prahlad Maharaj was also not seeing Krishna. He was not seeing like this. Before he appeared from the pillar, he was not seeing. But he had faith. Why he had faith? Because he had studied from a person who had faith. And who was that? Narad Muni. Narad Muni has strong faith. And that's why hearing from a devotee or hearing from Prabhupada directly is so potent, because he has strong faith. One time Prabhupada said to his disciples in one lecture, he says, you don't understand. Very sad. He started that lecture, I think in the start or in the middle, somewhere Prabhupada says, you people don't understand whom I'm asking you to worship. Who is he? You don't know him. And they said, we knew only Prabhupada. We did not know Krishna. We did not know who is God. We knew Prabhupada is what he is saying. He cares for us. And whatever he is saying is right. Shyamasundara Prabhu was saying, first time when he started carving Lord Jagannath, because Prabhupada had told him to carve, and because Prabhupada said, he is the Lord. He said, okay, he is the Lord. Otherwise, you know that anecdote I'll just tell you. When he was carving, he was still smoking. And Prabhupada asked him to carve Lord Jagannath's deity. So he was carving, and he used to smoke and keep the cigarette on the head of Lord Jagannath. So Prabhupada came there, and Prabhupada said, just a very simple thing. Prabhupada said, why you are bringing... Prabhupada did not chastise him. Hey, what are you doing? You are offending the Lord. He said, why you are bringing a small thing between you and Lord Krishna? Just a small thing. He said, what is that? The cigarette is a small thing between you and Lord. And that's what one godbrother of Prabhupada, he quoted one shloka when he was in conversation with Prabhupada. He said, what is that shloka? Ahankar yutnam hi madhye parvat rashaya. Ahankar nivrutta nam keshavo nahi durgaha. That Lord Keshav is sitting in our heart. And Atma and Lord Keshav are sitting close by. And what is in between them? Ahankar yutnam hi madhye parvat rashaya. Parvat means a big hill. A big mountain is between them. And that mountain is very thin actually, because there is not much difference between Lord Keshav and the Atma. But this mountain is very thin, but it is very long. It is very heighted. So we cannot see. And we have to just remove this ahankar. A little bit. Ahankar nivruttanam. Keshava nahi durga. Then Keshava is not very far. He is very close by. But we are not able to hear him because that ahankar plate is there. And that removal of ahankar comes by studying Prabhupada purports. And by studying them, and not just studying, but distributing them. Very important. Because the best student is one who teaches. That's why Gurukul education system, Prabhupada explains in the Gurukul education system, the guru, the main guru, used to teach 15, 20, whatever was his capacity. He used to guide them, first 15, 20 disciples. And each of those disciples had another 15, 20 under him. Of course, whenever they had problem with him, they could approach the guru. So this is very important thing. We should learn and we should distribute this knowledge. And that's what the 11th canto, that in that series, first is bhayam. Why bhayam is there and how to eradicate that bhayam? He says, shunvan subhadrani rathang paner janmani karmani chayani loke gitani namani tad arthakani gayan vilajjo vichareda sangaha. What we should do is shunvan. Subhadrani. Subhadrani means very, very auspicious. The most auspicious Leela Katha, the descriptions of Lord's pastimes. We should hear them. And Shunvan means very attentively and scrutinizingly hearing. Prabhupada writes some places, scrutinizingly hearing, not just hearing. Just hearing from this ear and leaving from here. But thinking about it and meditating. And Shunvan Subhadrani Rathang Paner. Whose katha? Rathang Paner. Who is the lifter of the chariot wheel when he was killing Bhishma, when he attacked Bhishma, Lord Krishna. And Janmani Karmani Chayani Loke. And we should hear with Tattva Gyan, scientifically, with Prabhupada purports, his Janma and Karma. How he is born, Prabhupada says in one lecture, Prabhupada says, everyone in India knows how Krishna was born. He was born in the prison. Everyone, every Tom, Dick and Harry, right from childhood, he knows how Krishna is born. Westerners don't know, Indians know. So if we go just tell them, oh, Krishna was born like this. Hey, Maharaji, I've heard this right from my childhood. But Tattva Gyan, what Shukdev Goswami, the first chapter, 10th canto, where Lord Krishna's description of his avatar is there, so much Siddhantas are explained by Shukdev Goswami. That understanding should be given. So we should memorize those shlokas. May not be in Sanskrit. We can have our own language also. That's no problem. Prabhupada one time, Prabhupada asked some devotee some question, and he was trying to answer it through a shloka. Prabhupada said, never said shloka. You tell me in English. Because that time the language was Sanskrit. Now the language is English, Hindi, Gujarati, whatever. So you speak in that language, but the same knowledge. So this is very important. Gitani namani tadarthagani. A devotee, what he does is, he speaks this and he gitani namani tadarthagani. And gayan vilajjo. With that gayan, when we preach like that, over a period of time, we become completely careless of what are these miseries of this material world. And we become abhayam and misery free. And we become very, very happy. But this is very important. We should Shunvan Subhadrani Rathanga Paner. We should hear carefully and then distribute. Gitani Namani. Gitani means to sing. Sing means to distribute. When Kirtan, Prabhupada says, Kirtan means glorifying the Supreme Lord. It could be with Mridangkartal or it could be with Pravachan. Both the things are Kirtan. And why this is very important preaching, I'll share an experience yesterday which we had and then I'll finish. We went to a school with Kamalakant Prabhu. We went to a school in Mathura. And all Brajwasis were there. Very nice, very sweet singing boys. And all boys were there. And they were very respectful. As soon as they entered the school, they touched the feet of all their masters, all their sirs, professors. And we gave a class. After the class, the main professor, he spoke. And he spoke what he spoke. My goodness, what an offense toward Lord Krishna. And this is Brajwasi we meet. And that's why Prabhupada said, don't have anything to do with local Brajwasis here. Because we are very weak in philosophy, we'll get allured by them. And all Brajwasis here are impersonalists. And what an impersonalism, what an offense. What he said, you know? He said, this Braja, this Vraj, this Vrindavan Dham is so great. These Maharajas are coming from Vrindavan Dham. Vrindavan Dham is so great that a small child, a black small child, who was called Kanha, this Vrindavan Dham made him God. To hear it looks good, isn't it? He's glorifying Vrindavan Dham, but he's offending Lord Krishna. That means he's offending the Dham. This Vrindavan becomes Vrindavan. Lord Chaitanya says that my heart is Vrindavan. Why? Because I am meditating on Krishna. Wherever Krishna is, that becomes Vrindavan. If Krishna is gone, that no more remains Vrindavan. That's what Prabhupada says when he was here in 1976. He said, don't go and hear any katha outside, because all people who are doing Bhagavad katha, they are Brajwasis, but they are talking Mayavad only. And Prabhupada can understand. If we go through Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavatam properly, we will also be able to understand. And that's why becoming a jnani is very, very important. Otherwise, we'll associate with anyone. We'll call anyone Brajwasi. We'll say, oh, he's Brajwasi. Because he's born in Braja, he's Brajwasi. No, that is not the qualification. Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati in Dushtaman, last shloka, he says, a real Brajwasi is one who has strong faith on Krishna and who preaches this message all over the world. That's a real Brajwasi. And that last shloka of that song. So with that, I would finish my presentation. If anybody has any criticism, or Prabhuji, anybody, Maharaj.
or any first criticism.
Mataji, whoever takes the mic, he will speak. That will be decorum should be maintained of the forum. Here, Prabhuji raised his hand. Yeah, okay, Prabhu. Yes. Sure. Yes, please.
Prabhu, just one small criticism. Please give more classes.
If you allow, Prabhuji. Panjivar Prabhu is here.
Thanks. God is giving in Bhagavad Gita that faith we should have. In this 1866, he is saying, Sarva Dharman Bhaita Jaya Mamrikam Sarnam Bhaita Aham Dham Sarva Dharman. Here he says, lead the all Dharma and just trying to be happy to you from all the situation. If you have faith in that one shloka, then no need to run here and there. Still, we are struggling and running here and there. So, can you say what, something over there?
Mataji also said the same thing. Prabhuji is also saying the same thing. If we have simple faith on Sarva Dharman Parityajya, then we don't have to run here and there. Mataji is also saying people are going there. Don't mind it. There are two things. We can't just blame the audience. We have to blame the speaker also. Sometimes it so happens that speakers don't speak on Prabhupada's purport. And they don't prepare. Sometimes devotees, very senior devotees also don't study Prabhupada every day. Then the classes are not attractive. Classes are not where they can learn something. So people get disinterested. So people don't want to come. Prabhupada didn't want it to be a dogma. Just have classes, just go on having classes. That is going on in Radha Damodar temple also. But you see, nobody wants to sit there. But if the speaker, Prabhupada was speaking very scientifically. So he attracted the crowd. Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati spoke so nicely. So he attracted. We have to prepare. We have to be honest with Srila Prabhupada. If we prepare class and give with nice, what Prabhupada is speaking, if we explain that, then we are honest to Prabhupada. We are loyal to Prabhupada. So we can't just blame one side. So we have to prepare. And to have faith on that, just one second. To have that faith on Sarva Dharman Parityajya, it seems very simple shloka. But to have that faith on Sarva Dharman Parityajya, the whole Bhagavatam is required. It's not so easy to have faith on Sarva Dharman Parityajya. Otherwise, why did Prabhupada waste his time writing purports on Bhagavatam and Chaitanya Charitamrita? We have to read that again and again and again and again, and then we get, oh, my faith on Sarva Dharman has increased. Oh, my faith has increased. So, that. No, just, yes, Maharaj.
Hare Krishna. If we take more than our quota, we're considered thief. If we take more than quota, we're considered thief.
Yeah.
So, if there's destiny, according to karma, how is it possible to take more than your quota?
Ah, okay. Maharaj is saying, very, very interesting question, very interesting question. Maharaj is asking that one side, if you take more than your quota, then you are thief, according to Ishopanishad. And the other side, that if destiny is fixed according to our karma, how can we take more than our quota? Very interesting. And one time I had this question and I came to one purport and Prabhupada very nicely describes it actually somewhere. I don't remember where exactly. Prabhupada says, you can't go above your quota, of course. But when you are considered thief, when you try to go above your quota. And now, Krishna is not a robot. What he does, even here in police does this. This was yesterday also when I was preparing one purport, it came that police already knows that he's a thief. Sometimes the police doesn't capture him immediately. They let them do more things. And then after some time, they give him chance. And this is Krishna's rule. Krishna is very merciful. Krishna gives him chance. Okay, go on. Okay, go on. Sometimes people say, why bad? Good things are happening to bad people. Why Dawood Ibrahim is flourishing? Wait for some time. Wait for some time. The pot has to become full and then it will be broken. Krishna is very cruel and Krishna is very merciful. But when Krishna is cruel, he is smiling only. He never becomes angry. Balaramji becomes angry, he becomes red-eyed. But Krishna coolly does, okay beta, go on, part! And then everything will be spoiled. So, then it's... Yes, probably last one.
Hare Krishna.
Yes.
Prabhuji, you said in the end that faith comes by jnana. And in Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna says just opposite that, Shraddhavan labhate jnana. And Prabhupada says in one purport in Bhagavad Gita that faith is created by the association of devotees, which is supported, which you said incident that different devotees came in contact with Prabhupada. So just by seeing the faith of Prabhupada, devotees gain faith in Krishna and Prabhupada. So how do you understand and how faith is?
Very nice. Prabhupada is asking, I said jnana increases faith, but Bhagavad Gita says Shraddhavan bhajate jnana, labhate jnanam. That Shraddha gives jnana. Very interesting. See, this is like a cycle. First we come to only those people take to Krishna consciousness, those who are Shraddhavan. Adav Shraddha. But then afterwards, that Shraddha has to increase through Adav Shraddha. So that, with that Shraddha, they hear devotees. Devotees say, study. At least, like GBC rule, at least 1 hour in a day. Okay, study. And then we do that, then Shraddha increases more. Then Jnana increases more. Then Shraddha, then Jnana, Shraddha, Jnana, Shraddha, Jnana, Shraddha.
This Shraddha is increasing by Jnana or by following the instruction and the mercy by which he has?
But I said Jnana are two types. One is to show off. Another is with the understanding, oh, because I have been instructed by the Acharyas. So, the second one is actual jnana, which makes one dear.
It means that a devotee who is even who cannot study, just like South Indian Brahman,
that's
also receive Shraddha by the mercy.
Yeah. Prabhupada says in many lectures, Prabhupada says, if you are learned, if you are inquisitive, and if you are curious, what we are, what are ISKCON, we have 80 books. In one Jagannath Rath Yatra, he used to say, we have 80 books, you can go through them. And if you are very simple, you are not scholarly person, then you just chant the holy names. Okay. And a disciple of Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati, he was an illiterate. But he just heard Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati and became a very great scholar. So, Shraddhan. Okay. So we'll finish here. Thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai.